Hey friends, on a recent episode of Azure Friday, we took a look at Azure Lighthouse, which provides a single control plane to view and manage Azure at scale. But some organizations have requirements that are more complex, such as those in regulated industries like finance. So how do you enable developers to onboard applications in Azure with self-service capabilities while still exercising control over an expanding cloud landscape? Jeff is here to show me how Fidelity, one of the largest financial asset managers in the world, is adopting Azure at scale with thousands of developers as part of their multi-cloud strategy today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hansman and it's Azure Friday. I'm here with Jeff Langfield from Fidelity. I think you may be our first customer. We've had vendors on, but you're building real stuff with Azure. So thank you for being here.
Thank you very much for having me.
Now you work in the cloud enablement or the Azure enablement group, and you're supporting a huge amount of technologists. How many people are thinking about the cloud at Fidelity right now?
We have approximately 14,000 technologists across the entire organization.
Wow, that is a lot of pressure. So then there's a cloud enablement group that is setting them up for success. What does that mean to enable them?
So the charter of the team is really to help accelerate. But again, because we work in a regulated industry, we've got to do things in a secure and a compliant manner. So our team's focus is ensuring we have governance standards with our deployments, and we're doing things in a secure manner, and that we look to abstract away some of the complexities of enabling services and cloud resources to align with those standards.
When I was working in finance many years ago before the cloud, that balance that we are in a regulated industry, we're doing work, whether it be with the Fed or we're moving money around, we cannot move fast and break things. But there was so much cool stuff happening in technology, and that tension between trying to set developers up for success, use new cool technologies, but also do it in a safe and secure way has been a real challenge. It sounds like you're trying to be able to do both of those things simultaneously.
Yeah, so we do have an environment where we allow our developers to explore a little bit more freely, you know, that's not connected to our on-premise network where they can go explore new services and play around with them. But when they're ready to start doing application development and connect back to our environment, that's where we want to be a little bit more secure and go through reviews of services and things like that.
Okay, that makes a lot of sense. And that allows them to boast the best of both worlds. And then I assume that you also provide a prescription for things like security reviews and all those kinds of things so that when it's time to go into production, there is a path for people.
Yeah, so with the example with a service, we have a detailed security assessment of that service. We take a look at the service from a data perspective, so protection and encryption. We look at it from identity and access management controls, network isolation, logging and monitoring, to name a few things.
Mm-hmm. So then to support all of these developers, your Enterprise Cloud Computing Group build an automation framework to kind of allow those folks to and business partners to onboard applications. So you've really automated a lot of things, not a lot of manual work happening here.
100% correct. So the framework, we call it Azure Automation Framework, very creative, AAF for short. Okay. And it's an event-driven architecture. And it's built entirely on cloud native services. Some of those services are Azure Function, web apps, logic apps, Event Grid, to name a few.
Wow. Okay. So then all of this sets people up for success so that they might onboard more quickly. Can you show me a demo of what that might be like?
Yeah. So let me log on to the user portal. So I'm in the AAF user portal right now, and I'm going to put in a product line number. So this won't mean anything to people watching this, but it's a way that we organize applications within our environment. So I'm going to go to the subscription where I want to enable a service. So in this demo, we'll enable Azure Functions. I'll go to the resource group. And the resource group is where we're assigning RBAC roles for services. And as you can see on this screen, we have services that have already been enabled. So some of these services, a user may have come to the portal and requested access. Some services we give by default, we call them birthright services. And then you see below, these are available services where a developer or user in an environment would come and request access. Again, mentioned earlier, we have that detailed security review. After that review's been completed, would make the service available within our AAF environment. And now a user can come and request access. And abstracting away that complexity also does a couple of things for us. It ensures that we can implement a least privilege model as it relates to configuring the service. It also ensures that we deploy services in a consistent, compliant manner. So I'll go next to the request button. You'll see I'll be asked a couple of questions. I'm just going to take the defaults and I'll hit request. And now you can see that the service is in the requested service state. Now, from a developer's perspective or a user's perspective, this is where their responsibilities end. They come into the portal, they hit request, and now they're just going to wait for the service to be enabled. But so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to show the workflow of kind of what's happening behind the scenes right now. So again, a user would come into the AAF portal. They'd find the environment where they want to enable the service. And again, the AAF framework, it's event driven. So we have a combination of Microsoft Microsoft native events, as well as custom events. In this particular example, where a custom event was generated, and that event is associated to a service enablement runbook. And what's happening within the runbook right now is it's assigning the RBAC role for functions. It's enabling the resource provider. And it's also doing a check from a network configuration perspective, because we're using the VNet integration option of Azure Functions. There's some network configurations that have to happen. So in this particular example, it'll check to see if there's already a subnet for the service. If not, it'll go check the VNet to see if there is addressable address space within the VNet to create a subnet. If both of those checks come back and are no, then it's going to call in a logic app endpoint. And what this first logic app in step one is doing, it's really just collecting metadata about the request. Now, because sometimes making network changes can cause a service interruption, all of the stuff on the left-hand side of the screen up to step one, these are tasks that are going to happen throughout the business day at any point in time, 24/7. But the tasks that are going to happen on the right side of the workflow, those are things that are going to happen during a predefined change window. So what ends up happening, so let's fast forward, say it's 7:15 tonight, the logic app in step two, that's going to kick off. And that's more or less just a queue manager for us. So the real work starts with the logic app in step three, called VNet resizing. And what this logic app is doing, it's going to double check again. Let's make sure we don't have a subnet dedicated for functions already. Let's check the CIDR again. And the reason that we're double checking thing is that these components are callable by other processes. So we don't just use it for service enablement. We can use it for other network onboarding activities or application onboarding activities. So now again, after it checks the subnet and it checks the VNet for addressable address space, if both of those checks come back no, we'll actually call an Azure function. And what this Azure function is going to do is make a call to an internal service that will go ahead and get a CIDR block. Now we're ready for step four, and this is where the breaking change is going to happen. So in order to expand a VNet, you actually have to break peering. So in our particular environment, when we break peering, we're going to break peering with the express route. That's going to cause a network interruption back to our on-prem environment. And so we want to do that again during a predefined change window. So we'll go ahead and break peering. We'll grab that CIDR block from step 3A. We'll expand the VNet. We'll re-peer. And now we're ready to create the networking for Azure Functions. We'll go ahead to step 5. We'll create a subnet. We'll assign an NSG rule set that's specific to this service. And then finally, we'll assign a RBAC role to allow users, once they have deployed Azure Function apps, to integrate with the VNet. So if I come back to the user portal, you know, if I in an environment where I did this last night, you'll see now Azure Functions shows up as an enabled service. And again, just to kind of conclude the framework again. So what the framework's allowing us to do is, again, is it's allowing us to deploy resources in a secure and compliant manner. Again, security and compliance is very important to us. It makes sure that our deployments from cloud resources to services are done in alignment with our governance standards. And as you can see from an end user or a developer's perspective, enabling Azure Functions was as easy as clicking a button. Now, if the developer had to do that on their own, there's a lot more configurations that they'd have to do from a networking perspective. And for some developers, that might be out of their comfort range. So again, they just come to a user portal, hit request, sit back, and just wait for the service to be enabled.
Are those requests something that the that a human has to okay, that a person has to say, I think that this is a good idea, or is this entirely automated at this point?
It's entirely automated.
Interesting. And then how complicated was it to decide how things should be? Like, this is best practices for Fidelity's cloud enablement, but other companies might be different, like the way you describe how you do your networking. I assume that enterprise architects all got together and thought about how we want these things to exist within the larger space inside of Fidelity.
Yeah. So from a networking perspective, network isolation and private networking is very important to us. So we'd like to keep things on our own internal private network as much as possible. From a security perspective around the service, again, review the service for the things I mentioned early, IAM, network, data. Now, from an RBAC model perspective, what we wanted to do was simplify how we use services. So we have essentially a one-to-one model. A service has an RBAC role. It's the same role that's used across the environment. So from a central perspective, we understand the permissions people are using when they use services, and we also understand how that service is being used, at least from a configuration perspective, across the whole environment.
And RBAC, of course, for folks that may be new to Azure, role-based access control, the idea of least privilege. Everyone should be able to do what they need to do, but no more. And if anyone gets into trouble and gets more access, or a bad actor gets involved, you want that bad actor to only be able to do what that role is allowed to do, which is really smart. And you've codified all of that. You've formalized it so that the developer thinks less about infrastructure and thinks more about the business problem at hand.
Absolutely. 100% right.
That's fantastic. How much do you think that other companies should do this themselves versus this should be something that's built into Azure? Because Azure does have things like Lighthouse and other ways to formalize this. Why did you feel that you needed to do it entirely, not entirely yourself, but this level of customization?
Yeah. So I think, from a, let's say, a Lighthouse perspective, that it wasn't going to meet the enterprise scale that we needed. But also, we have very specific governance requirements and policies and standards that I'm sure aren't necessarily unique to Fidelity, but financial services, they have certain things and regulations they have to follow. So we needed something that was flexible and extensible so we could align with what we wanted to do.
And what's cool about it is that it appears that if you look at things like runbooks and software-defined networking, you used Azure to work with Azure, to manipulate Azure. Like, you created a lot of software, but you basically had a bunch of Lego pieces you got to play with, link together, and make the cloud your cloud, the Fidelity cloud that follows the security guidance and prescriptions that your regulated environment requires, which is pretty fantastic.
Yeah, 100% Azure services were used in this framework and solution.
Cool. Well, I hope that people can learn more about this somewhere, because this is internal stuff. Like I said at the beginning of the show, you are our first customer to come on Azure Friday. Do you think that you'll be talking more about this publicly? Is this going to be something that I could read a white paper on perhaps in the future?
There's a possibility is open for that in the future. I know our organization in general is looking at more open source and being more involved in the community. So I think that's absolutely a viable option in the future.
Fantastic. I really appreciate that. I am learning all about how to enable at-scale adoption of Azure services for really large development communities like those at Fidelity. Thank you so much, Jeff Langfield, for chatting with me today on Azure Friday.
Thank you very much, Scott.
Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Azure Friday. Now I need you to like it, comment on it, tell your friends, retweet it. Watch more Azure Friday.